What's going on, everybody? Mr. Octagonal here, and we are back with the 30 Minutes on the Clock podcast, episode number 7 here of season number 2. And we have a very special edition of the series today. Usually I'm only uploading on Saturdays, or at least I'm usually only uploading this series, to be specific, on Saturdays. But we're going to break the rules a little bit because the NFL Scouting Combine has just kicked off yesterday, and it's going to be going out throughout the next week or so. So I wanted to give a Combine viewing guide, if you will, sort of what to expect, some guys to look out for. I try to avoid talking about all the top guys at each position per se, but there were a few guys I did want to highlight. So without further ado, let's get this show on the road. So as you can see, how I've arranged this is that we have 3 to 4 categories per position, and then my top 10 players at each position to the right side. I'm not really going to be going over that top 10 rankings, but if you feel that you may disagree with something, or if you question why I ranked one player over the other, I'd be happy to answer that in the comments below. So the categories are a guy who needs to perform well, my guy, which is basically the most underrated player at the position, in my opinion, the big name to watch this week, and then for quarterback, I added bonus because I feel like I have to talk about Tua. So the player who needs to perform well, I don't think there is a clear answer for the quarterback position because I don't think the combine is as imperative to quarterbacks as it is to other positions. But if I had to choose one, I would go with Jordan Love because Love is a guy who's known more so for his physical gifts rather than his production on the field. A guy like Joe Burrow, if he were to participate in the drills, which he's not doing most of them, I believe, he's not an athletic freak, and he does not have to perform well. Tua Tagovailoa, if he were to perform in the drills, he wouldn't have to do super well because of a production, and then I think the same sort of goes for Justin Herbert as well. But the thing with Love is he was not all that good this year. 17 interceptions, the production was not there against weak competition. So why is he the fourth quarterback on most people's boards, including my own? That's because of the physical gifts. He has a cannon for an arm. He's one of the most athletic quarterbacks in the draft. And I think here this week, he's going to make a lot of money or lose a lot of money. I think he has to perform well and live up to the expectations that he was going to shine here in this combine. And if he puts up pedestrian numbers, I don't think he'll be a first-round pick. My guy, the most underrated player of the position, in my opinion, is Justin Herbert. I don't think there is, once again, an obvious answer for this one because, obviously, Joe Burrow is by far the best quarterback prospect here, and I really don't think there's that guy who's super underrated. I think Jake Fromm's a little bit underappreciated, but I wouldn't call him my guy or anything. So we have Herbert. I think the reason why he's my guy is because he's above Tua on my board, and he's not above Tua on most boards. But I do think Herbert's a better prospect. I think Tua's the better player, but the medical concerns do scare me with Tua. And with Herbert, you know what you're getting, a guy who can win inside the pocket, he can win outside the pocket, he'll put up a good 40 time, he's quick, he's athletic, he has a strong arm, he's pretty accurate, and I think he's a very well-rounded player at the position. The name you need to watch this week is Jalen Hurts. Hurts is a guy who's known for his athleticism. Most of his game is done outside of a pocket as a scrambler or throwing on the run. And a lot of quarterbacks these past few years, to be specific, the athletic African-American quarterbacks have been brought up about playing different positions. Guys like Kyler Murray, Lamar Jackson, teams wanted to work these guys out as running backs and wide receivers. Obviously, Kyler Murray looks very good. Lamar Jackson just won an MVP. But Jalen Hurts is not as good of a prospect as either of those two. And I'm not suggesting Hurts should move positions. I think he is best suited as a quarterback. He is not the athlete that Kyler Murray is, and he's not the athlete that Lamar Jackson is. Those two are world-class athletes for the quarterback position. And while Hurts is a very good athlete, I would not put him in that world-class conversation. But I'm curious to see the numbers he puts up, if he can assert himself as a potential second round pick, because right now I don't think he is a second round pick. I'd say he's probably a late third, early fourth round pick at this point. And I just think he's just been too inconsistent over his college career. He's shown a ton of flashes, but he's also made a ton of mistakes. And I think he has a lot to prove, not only in the athletic drills, but also on the on-field drills. And then the last player we're going to talk about, I added a bonus section for quarterback because I wanted to talk about Tua Tagovailoa. Tua has the highest ceiling, in my opinion, for any QB in this draft, but I'm not as high on him as others. I don't think the Dolphins should trade up for him. I don't think they should pick him at 5 if Herbert's available. And that's not even suggesting that I think they should go with Herbert at 5. But I think Tua is a little bit overrated of a prospect. Yes, he has phenomenal intangibles. I think if he was fully healthy, I think he'd put up historic rookie numbers. But I don't think this guy has, like, that Patrick Mahomes, Lamar Jackson, Russell Wilson potential of being one of the top quarterbacks in the game. And then, obviously, the medical concern scares me. He's going to get a full medical report, I think, early March. I think March 9th is the date. So that's what you have to look out for with Mr. Tagovailoa. He's not going to be participating in any of the drills, obviously, as he continues to rehab his hip injury. And so far, it seems like his hip is definitely improving. It seems like it's progressing very well, but it's still a scary injury. And I think that teams should be cautious with Tua Tagovailoa drafting him so high. And then once they get him, they have to be smart with how they use him early on, a.k.a. probably don't play him a whole lot year one. Running back was actually one of the harder positions to do for this one. But we're going to start with the needs to perform well section. I gave that honor to Jonathan Taylor, and I expect that he will do pretty well during the combine, but I think he needs to if he wants to maintain his status as probably an early to mid second round pick at this point. And I think these top three running backs are really a toss up when it comes to their order, but I'm sure DeAndre Swift will do excellent, and I think J.K. Dobbins will do pretty well at the combine as well. So I think that puts a lot of pressure on Jonathan Taylor, a guy who has a fumbling issue and also maybe has gotten the ball a little bit too much in college. Maybe his legs aren't as fresh as some of these other players like Swift and Dobbins. And I think Jonathan Taylor will do well. I think he's going to put up better numbers than most people expect. I think he's a better athlete than most people expect. However, I do think he has a lot more pressure than most of the running backs in this class to do well this week. My guy, this was another tough one because there's not a running back who I necessarily love, but I went with Clyde Edwards-Helaire. Looking at it now, I'm quite high compared to others on Anthony McFarland out of Maryland. I probably could have gone with him, but we are going to go with Clyde Edwards-Helaire, who I think is a very well-rounded back. I think he's very polished. I think he will make an immediate impact day one for whoever picks him. And I definitely take a chance on him in the second round if I'm a team looking for a running back, assuming those top three guys are off the board. I think Clyde is that clear number four back. I think you have that tier one of guys, which will be Swift, Dobbins, and Taylor. But then you get into that tier two range, and I think Clyde Edwards-Helaire and maybe Cam Akers are the only ones in there. I think Clyde Edwards-Helaire really separates himself from some of these other backs who people view as mid-round selections. And then the name to watch is going to be Cam Akers. I think he has a real shot to improve his draft stock this week, probably a late second, early third round pick at this point. And I think he has some proving to do. I mean, he hasn't been the superstar that we've really expected these past couple of seasons after dominating early on in his career at Florida State. And it's not all his fault because the organization has fallen off when it comes to football these past couple of years. And you cannot put the blame on Cam Akers' shoulders for that at all. However, I do think Cam Akers is certainly going to be one of those interesting prospects to watch this week at the running back position. Next up, we're going to be looking at the wide receiver position. This is a very deep position in this class, and if you've been following the 2020 NFL draft, you know that this is a very deep position. There are some great players I left off this list. Donovan Peoples-Jones, Van Jefferson, Bryan Edwards, Michael Pittman, Courtney Davis, KJ Hill, Isaiah Hodgins, Antonio Gandy-Golden, Devin Duvernay, Gabe Davis. All of those guys, I think, are day two to early day three draft picks, and none of them are in my top 10 for wide receivers. So the guy who I think needs to perform well is Brandon Ayuk from Arizona State. And sort of like Jonathan Taylor, I think he'll put up better numbers than most people expect, but I do think he does need to perform well if he does want to slide into that first round consideration, because there are probably 6 or 7 guys slotted to go in the first round, and I don't think any of them are currently Ayuk. And I think his stock really varies throughout the entire second round. I could see him going early second, late second. So I think he does need to perform, but I think he physically doesn't get it really talked about enough, and I'm sure that he will improve his stock this week. My guy, one of my favorite players in this draft class is Jalen Reagor. And if you look at his measurements from yesterday, a little bit over 5'10", over 10-inch hands, I think the measurements were a big win for him. And Jalen Reagor has a phenomenal skill set. Obviously, he's a deep threat. He's known for his speed. He's a guy who has a legit shot to run a sub-4.3, but that he's not just a speed guy. He's not just a guy who can stretch the field, but he can jump. I mean, he can go for jump balls even though he's not a big guy. Obviously, you have players like T. Higgins who are giants and can easily go up and try to snag balls away from defensive backs. But I think Jalen Reagor does that very well as a 5'10 guy. And I think he is certainly the wide receiver 4 in this class. And if he was in last year's class, he'd be my wide receiver 2 behind DK Metcalf. That's how much I love Jalen Reagor out of TCU. And then the name to watch this week, there are a bunch of names to watch at this position, but I think the only possible answer for this one is Henry Ruggs. I mean, we're just going to state the obvious. This guy has a legitimate shot to break John Ross's 40-yard dash record today. During the interviews, he said his goal was to break that record of 4.22. And there are some burners at the receiver position. As I mentioned, Jalen Reagor is going to run right around that 4.3 range. KJ Hamler, another one out of Penn State, I think he's going to run a really fast time as well. But Henry Ruggs is the fastest player in this draft class, and he does have a legit shot to break John Ross's record. Do I think it's going to happen? If I were to guess, probably not. But there is a real possibility that Henry Ruggs does break that record. My over-under for Ruggs' 40 time right now is 4.26. And let me know in the comments, do you think he's going to run a better time than that? Do you think he's going to run a worse time than that? But I'm sure Henry Ruggs will wow all of us with his 40-yard dash time, whether it's in the low 4.2s, the high 4.2s. And that's really the only possible range for his 40 time, because it is not going in the 4.3s or lower. So that's why Henry Ruggs is my name to watch this week, and I'm sure all eyes are going to be on Ruggs as he does that 40-yard dash. And I want to talk about Ruggs a little bit more as a player. I mean, people talk about him as just a speed guy. He's not. He's a really, really solid all-around receiver who just happens to be really fast. So while he is the wide receiver 3 for me, I don't think he gets enough credit as an all-around player, more, and he only gets talked about as a speedster, and I think he's closer to that top 2 of Jerry Jeudy and CeeDee Lamb than most people think, and that's coming from someone who's very high on both Jerry Jeudy and CeeDee Lamb. Now on to the tight end position, and the guy who I think needs to perform well is Thaddeus Moss. Obviously, he's going to have eyes on him as the son of Randy Moss. I think Thaddeus Moss is a little bit overhyped, and I think he needs to prove it to me, personally, to have him rise up my board. Currently, he's my number 6 tight end, but I think he needs to prove it to some of his scouts. I mean, he had a nice stretch towards the end of last season, but I think he's still very raw and has some work to do, and I think a lot of the reason why he's ranked so high is his name value. Being part of the Moss family, the son of Randy Moss, one of the most talented receivers to ever play the game. So I think Thaddeus Moss has a lot to prove this week, and I'm curious what his numbers will be. My guy is going to be Harrison Bryant. He's a very, very well-rounded receiver out of Florida Atlantic. Doesn't get talked about enough as a potential day 2 selection. I have him ranked higher than Thaddeus Moss as my number 5 tight end. And really, I think he could put 2 through 5 on that board in any order. And I don't think Cole Kmet at number 1 is really that much higher than the rest of the group. So really 1 to 5, I think they're all very close within each other. And I think those first 4 guys are going to be day 2 selections. But Harrison Bryant in like the 4th or 5th round, you're getting an absolute steal. And this is a guy who I think has the upside to be a starting caliber tight end in this league. And then the name to watch this week is Adam Trautman out of Dayton. He's my number 2 tight end. I'm very high on him. However, as I mentioned, 2 through 5 can really just go in any order. I'm very curious to see what his numbers are going to look like and see if some people can really get as high on him as I am. Currently, I expect him to probably be a 3rd round pick, but I think if he does well, I think he could cement himself as a 2nd rounder and one of the first three tight ends taken. So while this is not the sexiest position this year, I think there are more interesting positions to talk about than tight end. There are a few guys who could go day two and make some big, big impacts right away. Next, we got offensive tackles, and I do want to go over my top 10 rankings for just a second. I want to go over that top four, Mekhi Becton, Andrew Thomas, Jedrick Wills, and Tristan Wirfs. I feel really bad for putting Wirfs at four because I think he's an absolute stud, and I think you could put that top four in really any order. I think they're all top 10 prospects in this draft, and considering how important offensive tackle is, I think all four of them should be top 10 picks. However, someone had to be fourth, and I think it is going to be Tristan Wirfs. However, once again, you could put those top guys in any order. So now on to the names to watch this week, starting with the guy who needs to perform well. That's Josh Jones out of Houston. I'm not as high on Jones as others. I have him as my number 7 offensive tackle in the class. He just needs to prove it to me. He had a very good season this year at Houston. He looked good in the Senior Bowl, and then the measurables today look outstanding. I mean, he measured in really, really well. However, I still think he's really, really raw, and I think his stock definitely varies. I think he could go top 15. I think he has a chance to be a late third, early fourth. I think his stock really is just out in the air right now, and it just seems very undecided, and I think this is such an important few days for Josh Jones. I think he needs to test extremely, extremely well. And I think he is very athletic. And I think he will test well. And I think he'll be a little bit overdrafted probably in that 15 to 25 range, if I were to guess. But I mean, he has such a high ceiling. If you look at the measurables and the season he had this year, he was outstanding. But I just still think he's raw. He gets sloppy and he has a lot of work to do. So my guy, Mekhi Becton out of Louisville. I love Mekhi Becton. Top 5 prospect in this draft. Maybe my highest ranked offensive player entirely in this class. I'd probably say him or Burrow or maybe one of the wide receivers, Judy, or I guess only Judy since he is my number 1 there. But Mekhi Becton is a physical specimen. Over 6'7", 364 pounds with long arms. This is a gigantic man, and he moves extremely well for his size. He's very mobile. I think he is the highest ceiling out of all the offensive tackles in this class, which is why I have him ranked so high. And I think just his body of work, and I mean, this is such a large human, and he can just be unstoppable at certain times. And I think he'll test really, really well for a guy as big as him. And then the names to watch, I had to put 2 here. One of them being Mekhi Becton. I just cannot wait to see the numbers he puts up. He's going to put up outstanding numbers for a man of his size. And then Austin Jackson, a player whose stock I think will really improve after this combine. I think he'll be the 6th tackle off the board, and I do think he will be a first-round pick. I saw a report on Twitter the other day from a reliable source that said he could sneak into the top 15 with a good combine, and he is one of the better athletes at the offensive tackle position in this draft class. So I could see him performing really well, and I could see him really leveling up to a mid to late first round pick, and I think that's right around where his talent matches up. And I think picking him around that 20-ish range, I think, is more than fair value for Austin Jackson. And I think he is one of the more slept-on players in this draft class. Next up, we got the interior offensive linemen. And I think the interior linemen in this class are a little bit worse than the offensive tackles. But I do think a lot of these players are certainly underrated, starting with a guy who I think needs to perform well. And that's Lloyd Cushenberry out of LSU. A lot of people have him as their number 1 interior offensive lineman. I don't. I have him at number 3. But I do think he needs to perform well. He is quite raw still, and he needs to be a little bit more consistent. But I think the talent is there, and he probably is the 2nd highest ceiling for any of the interior linemen. I'd probably still say the highest ceiling belongs to Cesar Ruiz from Michigan. But I want to see what Cushenberry does. He's probably the interior offensive lineman, at least, that I'm most curious about for this combine. And I think if he performs well, he'll probably be the first one off the board. My guy, we could have gone with 2 here. I'm very high on Cesar Ruiz, or at least higher on him the most. But I wanted to go with Netane Muti. Muti is one of my favorite players in this class. He is really, really talented, and I love his skill set a lot, and I think he is severely underrated. I think he is absolutely a second-round talent. The only question with him is his durability. He has had a couple of Achilles injuries and then had another injury this year, and he has not played a lot of football for Fresno State, but when he's on the field, he is really, really good. So the only question with him is can he stay healthy? If he does, I think he'll be a great, great player, but the health is a gigantic concern with Netanne Muti. So while as much as I love him, the health concern is there. And then the name to watch this week is Jonah Jackson. Performed well at the Senior Bowl, and his name is really starting to rise these past couple of weeks. And I think he's cemented himself, at least as of now, as a day two pick. And if he performs well, I think he could make himself a higher day two pick. Probably not a first rounder, but I think he has a chance to make himself one of the probably first three interior offensive linemen off the board. So I think Jonah Jackson is a guy who you should probably have your eyes on. Now we're going to go to the defensive side of the ball, starting with edge rusher. I think that tier one of guys being Chase Young, AJ Epenesa, and Kalevon Chaisson have really cemented themselves as the top three edge rushers in this class, which I think puts a lot of pressure on Yetur Gross-Matos. He's a guy who I think really needs to perform well because that second tier of edge rushers is really deep. And Gross-Matos is the number one tier two edge rusher on most people's boards, including my own. But he could probably put six or seven guys in that conversation. I think everybody else on this board from 5 to 10 is in that tier 2 range. I think Bradley Ane out of Utah is in that tier 2 range. And then sneaking up on those guys, I'd probably include John Grenard out of Florida, Jabari Zuniga out of Florida, a big sleeper of mine, Alex Highsmith out of Charlotte. So Yetur Gross-Matos has a lot of talented edge rushers right behind him. And even if he does average, I think he has to outperform everybody else. And even if he does average, even if he does bad, I think there are going to be guys that are really impressive and pass him. Even if he necessarily doesn't have a bad week, he has to outperform all these other guys. So for the my guys section, I wanted to add two players here, starting with Terrell Lewis. First round talent without a doubt. Talent-wise, he's probably the number four edge rusher in this class, but the medical concerns are apparent. Sort of like Netanne Muti, I think Lewis's stock is currently higher than Muti, and Lewis is being talked about more than Netanne Muti, but the point remains. Terrell Lewis had torn elbow ligament back in 2017. In 2018, he had a torn ACL, which is obviously a big deal. Knee injuries are always a very big deal. He was healthy this year, and he played very, very well this year, and I think he fits the modern profile of today's edge rusher extremely well, which is why I like him so much, but the medical concerns are there. And then another version of today's modern edge rusher, Josh Uche out of Michigan. He's small, 6'1", 241 according to the Draft Network. We will have official measurements on him later, I believe, once the edge rushers start coming in, which I believe is tomorrow. So I think we'll get their measurements tomorrow. But Uche is not the biggest. He's not a guy who's going to have his hand in the dirt. He is a 3-4 outside linebacker, and he's quick off that edge. He's fast. He's versatile. And that's why he's one of my favorite players in this class. Sort of like Terrell Lewis, he fits the mold of a modern edge rusher. And then the name to watch is going to be Darryl Taylor out of Tennessee, who I'm very high on. I think he's one of the best athletes at this position, and he's going to put on a show in Indy. Not really being talked about as a potential late second, early third round guy, but I think he's absolutely in that conversation. And I also had Kalevon Chaisson's name in this section, but it was announced today that he's not going to participate in any of the drills. He's going to do them at the LSU Pro Day. So I decided to take his name out, and I had both him and Darryl Taylor in there, so I figured I'd just keep Taylor. And I just want to go back to how deep this position is. I mean, you got Curtis Weaver at 10th. His stock hasn't really dropped for me these past couple of weeks. It's just that these guys above him, I've really started to get high on. And Curtis Weaver is easily a top 50 prospect in this draft class. But it's just that there's so many talented guys, somebody has to get the short end of the stick. Same with Bradley Ane, who I think is a really, really good prospect out of Utah. He missed out on the list, but I think he's a top 50 player in the draft. Now onto the interior defensive line position, starting with a guy who needs to perform well, and that's Justin Madubuike out of Texas A&M. He's one of the more confusing prospects in this draft. I think he's one of the more talented interior defensive linemen, but the production wasn't always there, a little bit inconsistent. The motor wasn't always 100% with him, and I think he needs to prove himself at the combine. He's going in the second round in a lot of mock drafts, including my recent one to the Lions, which having him as the ninth interior defensive line shows that I'm not being a biased Lions fan with these mocks, but I think he does need to prove it. I think he's probably one of the five or six most talented players at the position, but he just didn't quite show it at A&M. And I think this is a big combine for him, and I think he needs to step it up. My guy is going to be Ross Blacklock out of TCU. Obviously, you have the tier one at this position with Derek Brown and Javon Kinlaw. Most people think Brown is far better than Kinlaw. I don't. I think the gap is closer than most people think. I'm a little bit lower on Derek Brown than others, but I'm quite high on Javon Kinlaw, which is why I think those two, I wouldn't say they're neck and neck, but Derek Brown only has a small edge over him. But Blacklock is my number three. He's been really, really good for TCU. Missed 2018 with an Achilles injury. Once again, medical concerns. You're noticing a common theme here of my guys. Guys who are talented and have high ceilings, but also have low floors. And that's the type of prospect I like. I think having safe prospects is good, but I prefer the type of guys who have the potential to be really, really good, even if their floor is low, even if there are concerns such as medical for a guy like Ross Blacklock. And then the name to watch this week is Neville Gallimore. Doesn't really get talked about enough as an elite athlete at the position. I have him as my number five interior defensive lineman. Most people have him at three or four. I'm not as high on him as others, but I do think he is going to be a good, probably second round pick. I think that's where he's probably going to go, and I think that's fair value for a guy like Neville Gallimore. I think he's going to put up really, really good numbers here at the combine. Originally, I had Derek Brown and Javon Kinlaw at this spot because I wanted to see if one of them would really do far better than the other. But now that Javon Kinlaw will not be testing, he's rehabbing an injury that he suffered, I think, during the Senior Bowl. So he's put more of a focus on rehab than training for the combine, so that's why he's not participating. And I figured it wouldn't really make sense to have Derek Brown alone here, so that's why I went with a guy like Neville Gallimore. Next up, we're going to be looking at the off-ball linebacker position, starting with a guy who I think needs to perform, and that's Kenneth Murray, because the top linebackers in this class, Isaiah Simmons, if you even can classify him as a linebacker, I just view him as a versatile monster, but I guess we have to list him somewhere, so he is listed here. There's also Patrick Queen, who I think is going to do really, really well this week. So that leads us with Kenneth Murray, the other guy who's probably going to be a first or early second round selection. And I think he needs to perform. A little bit inconsistent at times, but he's really, really talented. He has a ton of range, solid in a run defense, but he just needs to get a little bit smarter on the field. And I think he has a whole ton of potential, but I think he just needs to unlock some of it. And I think this week can certainly help him out. For my guys, we have two. One of them is Isaiah Simmons. I know I wanted to avoid from using top prospects. He is a top prospect, but I just love him so much. This is my number two player in the draft behind Chase Young. And then my other one is Patrick Queen. There's not a whole lot of guys I love outside of this top group. I am very high on Malik Harrison and Akeem Davis-Gaither, so I think either one of them would have worked there. But I really, really like Patrick Queen. I think he's easily a top 20 player in this draft class. The kid flies all over the field. He's going to have a great combine. He's not the biggest. His frame and his length don't help him. He's only 6'1", doesn't have super long arms, but I think the talent is there, and he's really, really good. And then the name to watch this week, I just couldn't help myself again. I had to go with Isaiah Simmons. This man is a freak. He's going to put up historic numbers. The best overall athlete, in my opinion, in the entire class. I mean, he's so, so versatile, such an athletic monster. I just cannot wait to see the numbers that he puts up. And the things I want to see most this week, outside of Henry Ruggs' 40 time, have to be Isaiah Simmons' numbers. I'm really, really curious to see how good he performs this week. Now on to cornerback, and this is also a really, really deep position in this year's class. The top seven guys for me are all first-round talents, and then 8 to 10 are all early second-round guys. And then a few players I had to leave off, like Troy Pride out of Notre Dame, super high on him, AJ Terrell. I think both of those guys are top 50 prospects, and they're not even showing up here. So the guy who has to do really well is Christian Fulton out of LSU. Fulton is currently the CB2 on my board, along with most other boards. But this is similar to why I think Yetur Gross-Matos has to play well. You have that clear tier one, which at this position is Jeff Okuda, and only Jeff Okuda. But then after that, I think the rest of the first round guys, and probably the early second round guys, all occupy tier two. So even if Christian Fulton doesn't do bad, he has to outperform everybody else if he wants to keep his stock. And he's a guy, even if he performs pretty well, I could see him going down just because this is a really, really athletic position. For the My Guys tab, I just couldn't control myself. I had to add three. Jeff Gladney, who I love. I've been high on Jeff Gladney since I started my draft research. Super physical corner, solid ball skills, pretty good in coverage, very, very well-rounded player, and he's going to test well this week. A guy who I'm just starting to get high on, Noah Igbinoghene out of Auburn. He's a really, really good player. He's going to surprise some people as one of the better players in this combine. I had him as the second corner off the board in my last mock, and I don't think that's unreasonable at all. As of right now, Noah Igbinoghene to me is a first-round prospect, and if he performs the way I expect him to, I think he'll be a first-round pick. And then Bryce Hall out of Virginia, easily a first-round talent. He had an injury. I believe it was an ankle injury. And his stock has really declined. He's at this point, it looks like he's probably mid to late second, maybe early third. But I think that's absurd. I don't think it's a serious, serious injury that's really going to halter his NFL career. And Bryce Hall is one of the most underappreciated players in this draft class. I think he's easily worthy of a first-round pick. And I think whoever gets him is going to get an absolute steal. And then the player to watch here is going to be Jeff Gladney, the guy who I've had my eye on since day one. I've been high on him since the start of the draft process, whereas Igbinoghene, I've really been high on him for the past week or so. And Gladney's going to test really, really well. I mean, as I mentioned, he's a very good all-around player, and he's a phenomenal athlete. I can't wait to see his numbers. And I've been saying since January with my first mock, Jeff Gladney is going to be a first-round pick, and he's going to prove it during the combine. Well, here you go. This is the opportunity. Jeff Gladney will prove himself, and he will be a deserving first-round pick. The final position group we will be taking a look at is the safety position. Not one of the deeper ones in this class, but I do still think there are some very, very talented players here. Starting with the guy who needs to perform well, I was going to put Grant Delpit here because he had a very inconsistent season, and I figured the combine would be a great opportunity for him to really show why that he was regarded as a top 10 prospect at the beginning of the year. But he will not be testing this week, so we're going to give that honor to Antoine Winfield Jr. instead. I've been high on Winfield for a while. Towards the beginning of the draft process, a lot of people had him as a third or fourth round guy. I had him going in the second. That's where I predicted he'd go since the start. And that's where I thought he belonged, and now it seems like a lot of people are starting to agree with that, so I'm going to just pat myself on the back there. And the reason why I put Winfield here is because he's not going to test well at 40. He does not have great straight-line speed, so he's going to need to do well everywhere else. The agility drills, the jumping drills, and then I think the most important ones are the on-field drills for Antoine Winfield Jr. I think he really needs to impress there to keep his value as a mid-second-round pick. My guy is going to be Jeremy Chinn. I would go with Kyle Duggar here, but I wanted to spice some things up. We're going to talk about Duggar in a minute. So we're going to go with Chinn here instead out of Southern Illinois. The kid's an absolute playmaker. I mean, he's been a turnover machine since they acquired him, and he's one of my favorite players in this draft class. I can't wait to see the numbers he puts up, and I think he's a really, really underrated player. He just made plays in their back and their secondary, and I think he's definitely a guy you got to watch out for come draft time. And then the name to watch this week is going to be Kyle Duggar. Really, really good athlete out of Lennar Rhine. I want to say they're Division II. They're not even FCS, but I have Duggar as my number three safety in the class. He's really risen my board the past couple of months. Super high on him. He's been so, so good for them. I understand he hasn't played the best of competition, but he's going to show you why he is such a highly regarded prospect this week. He's going to put up ridiculous numbers, and I do expect him to be probably an early to mid-second round pick when it's all said and done. So that'll end the episode. I hope you guys enjoyed. Make sure to hit the like button and subscribe. I will have a combine recap video up early next week, so make sure to stay tuned for that. And as always, have a good one. Peace out, and enjoy the combine.